Ladies and gentlemen, thank you and welcome to the Chan Berry Show. We are back, and I just can't believe who I am blessed to have in the house. Two of my good friends.
Is the check going clear?
Did I say that? Not until Thursday. The voice, that voice, it comes from my good buddy, actor, performer. He's just all around, just good. One of my best friends. His name is Richard Roundtree.
Hey! In the house! Tree in the house!
Trees in the house! And the other brother who's sitting next to me, next to Richard, is...
London, you got a check?
Oh my God, but these checks, you guys are killing me with these checks.
Okay.
There's no checks here. Oh,
I'm sorry, I didn't read the small
All right,
print.
So see you.
Check set? Yeah.
So, ladies and gentlemen, you know how this show's about to go. So, you know, sitting next to Richard Roundtree is my good buddy. His name is Glynn Turman.
In the house.
Hey, I almost left of him.
So, you know, it has never been a moment when we were in each other's presence where we were just laughing and crying like we were just doing a few minutes ago and just cracking jokes and telling stories. So this is what we will continue to do on the show. But let me tell you something. Richard Roundtree, you know, many people, well, the world will know him as this icon character, as Shaft. And everywhere you go, you know, people know the word Shaft.
Fast forward.
The soundtrack was amazing by Isaac Hayes. It's one of the, iconic pieces of music that is a part of our history.
Academy Award winner.
Exactly. And Richard has gone on way past that to play other characters.
Hello.
To do other things, stage and screen, also Broadway. Also sings a little bit also, and also recorded an album, for those who don't know. But movies like Seven, and, you know, he's been on The Fresh Prince, and, you know, Lincoln Heights, and other movies, and he's a part of the Shaft franchise with Samuel L. Jackson now. And they have a new movie coming out, which is the second or the third?
Cinco.
Really? No, I'm talking about with Sam.
Oh, with, yeah.
With Sam. It's the second or third?
Yeah, second.
Second with Sam. Okay. And, you know, my buddy Glynn, with Glynn, I first recognized his talent as a little boy on Broadway in a play. And I believe his name was Travis.
That was his name.
And I think Glenn...
Hated that name.
I think Glenn probably was about 9 or 10 years old.
Hated the name.
Yeah.
I thought it was the worst name.
Looking good for 85 years old, isn't
he? Oh, that's messed up.
I knew it was coming sooner or later, ladies and gentlemen.
84, if you please.
84, if you please.
No, that's a joke. No. Somebody hit the stick.
Glenn's not 84, trust me. No. So, you know, with that iconic play, Glenn grew from there. And, you know, one of the things that he's been tagged with is this movie called Cooley High, done in 1975, as Preach. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have to move on from that.
I want to say something here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
From the bottom of my heart, this man to my right is a beast.
He is a beast. God knows he's a beast.
And he's in the last few years, I think he's starting to get acknowledged for his
beastdom. For his beastdom.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Yeah.
And it isn't enough.
I thank you, Ricardo. You know, coming from you, that does mean. Doesn't mean shit coming from you. No.
Let's keep it real.
You know, that's just such a cheap shot. Anything for a joke, you know.
You know what?
You know, this is the man.
What, Glynn,
you know,
gonna,
I love you.
Glynn, you I'm going to have to drink on that one.
He may be right,
no,
baby.
No. No, this is my hero to my left here.
Yes, that's right. That's
talking
right.
About him the other day. He's the man. Just not. And the thing about Treater so cool is, you know, everybody knows how cool he is on screen, but he's the coolest man.
Yes, he is.
Human being.
He's getting deep up in
here. He's the coolest human being. He's a genuine human being. Yeah. You know that? And that's how we all feel about Treen,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
My wife is like, did you call Richard? You know, it's like, you know.
Oh, Joanne is my biggest fan. Come
yeah,
on,
sure. I mean to tell you. That's right.
You know, I'm very familiar with these guys' careers and some of their personal life. I've known Joanne for a while, but I met Glynn years ago when Glynn was in New York doing a play which inspired me. He did a play called In White America in New York. That ran a short spell, and he played Nat Turner.
Mm. Yeah, no, Do Lord Remember Me.
Do Lord Remember Me.
That was what that was, yeah, Do Lord Remember Me,
okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. I thought it was In White America, but I guess it was Do Lord Remember Me. And I went to see that, and I interviewed him afterwards, and we spoke about that. Mm-hmm. And that was that had to be in the 80s.
Yeah.
In the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And that, when I was coming out of school at Rutgers University, I was in radio and television and working for Frankie Crocker at the time.
Oh, get out.
As Frankie's assistant in New York. And thinking about, you know, wanting to be a director, but wanting to be a better director by taking acting courses, which I started at Rutgers with Lee Richardson.
Okay, yeah.
And
NEC?
No, who played Hawk?
Oh,
Avery Brooks.
Avery Brooks. Right?
Avery Brooks was my acting coach also.
Yeah. Avery's a bad man. He's just another
Avery
beast.
Avery
right
is
there.
A beast.
He's a bad man.
But after seeing Glynn in that play, it made me want to really step up my game as an actor and go for it. And I used to use. From this play called In White America, the Nat Turner piece as the runaway revolt slave thing. Yeah. I used to use that as my monologue when going out for things. But it was due to you that I was with that. But, you know, both of you have been just, you know, pieces of my heart and my soul and my spirit. So it's no wonder that we now are our friends, because I had kind of threw that out in my younger days that, you know, the people that I really admired, especially the black men in this business, such as Sidney and Morgan and you guys and Joe Morton and a few others, everybody pretty much became friends and have been able to accept me, you know, as a friend and, let me in to see the inner workings of what you black men are like in Hollywood. Playing the parts and being the parts and being just real men when you step out of those stages and being able to have real conversations with me. And it helped me a lot to get through my manhood. So once again, thank you. So one of the things I wanted to talk to you, both of you guys about is, you know, having the careers that you guys have had, being the men that you have been, and what is it like being an African-American man who is an actor performer, writer, director, producer, and looking back at your life this time, what is it like now? Out of all the stuff you've done, what is life like for you now? And what's ahead for you? What's ahead of you, for you to do? Because you've done so much. You've been through so much. You've said so many things. You stood for so many things, especially in the 60s and the 70s. But here you are now, seasoned men. When you look back, what do you see? And then what's for the future?
That's a hard one for me. Hmm. And Shan, you know me. Mm-hmm. What I said earlier about this man to my right being a beast, you know, I look at the career, and I've been incredibly fortunate. I remember getting on a bus after The Shaft came out, and the bus driver said, "Hey, you hadn't done a lot of work." I said, no, I haven't been very lucky. He said, no. You either pay getting on or getting off, but you got to pay dues. And I look at guys like Glynn and their resume, if you will. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have been very lucky, because what I said earlier is very true for me. These guys are beasts. Mm-hmm. Their work ethic and what they have put into their careers and how they are looked at in the industry. Mm-hmm. I can't honestly place my ascension anywhere near moi.
Well, I don't know. You know, there's a franchise. Hollywood is still living off of this man.
True. This is true.
I don't want to hear it, Dre. I don't want to hear it. I know what you're going to say, but I don't want to hear it. Hollywood is still paying bills off of what this man did. Mm-hmm. Hollywood is still paying bills off of what several of us have done. Mm-hmm. I call this the back nine of my career. You know, I am amazed that at the work and the projects that are coming to me at this particular time. But it's only coming because of, believe it or not, the groundbreaking work that we did back in the day in terms of breaking down doors, mm-hmm. challenging images, protesting, mm-hmm. and standing fast to images that we thought meant something. You never seen this man do an image that was not upright and standing. Mm-hmm. And you know, we got to eat.
True. True.
You know, so true. Ain't nothing wrong with doing something against what your principle is, you know, because you got to eat. So your higher principle may have been, I got to feed my family at this time.
Right.
Hell with the image. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? That's a principle. That's a stance that you have to take. But on the whole, I see the images and the cats who are coming forward now and the ladies who are coming forward now, and the things that are being accepted, the productions that are being done. Our whole thing at that time was about being true to us as a people. the images that were going to last and make a difference as a people, mm-hmm. you know. And for to have laid that groundwork and now to have that, those seeds come back to where they say to me and Richard, you know, now we need the crowning piece.
Mm-hmm. For the table.
For the table. I was gonna say, well, mm-hmm. I'll be damned. You know, I lived long enough. Mm-hmm. I fooled you. I fooled you.
You know, and Tree and I have this conversation all the time, mm-hmm. is that you two are always working. If it's not television, it's film. You two are always working. Samuel's always working. Morgan is always working. Joe is now always working. You five cats are always working. And working on things that mean something. You know, Glenn, I think it was The House of Lies.
Mm-hmm. House of Lies, Don Cheadle, House of Lies, Showtime. Wonderful show.
And then...
Groundbreaking show.
Mm-hmm. You know, and... Tree being Mary Jane.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Groundbreaking for BET.
Mm-hmm.
One of the best shows ever.
Ever.
For BET.
Mm-hmm.
But they got the right people to be in it.
That's right. Finally.
Right. Mm-hmm. The right writers.
I should have said that.
I'm going to repeat what Glenn said. Finally.
Mm-hmm.
Another groundbreaking experience mm-hmm. for BET and for us people who look like us.
Mm-hmm.
Another family, you and Margaret,
mm-hmm.
Avery, another friend.
Mm-hmm.
You know, between the television and the movies and everything else, how have you guys been able to find or not find balance in being daddies?
Mm. Wow. Balance.
I have to drink on that.
Service?
I don't know. Chan gave me a glass with a hole in it.
Yeah, the hole in the bottom. Yeah.
Oh, have mercy.
Anyhow, balance. That's a tough one for me. I have five kids. The youngest one just turned 20 years old. My son, the only man child I have. Four daughters. And I'm still looking for that. I have an incredible relationship with my oldest daughter. A good one with her younger sister. Mediocre.
With the third?
Yeah. And a relatively good one with my son. But to be totally candid, the oldest one is the only one that gets me.
Mm. Well, she's been around long enough to understand daddy.
Yeah, much to my dismay. I mean, I wish there was a closer bond with my kids.
With the others?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I've never learned how to bridge that. And part of that is due to the divorces.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not in the house, you know, it's difficult. You know, you said something to me yesterday, I think we talked. that you had this conversation with your boys at their age about what kind of school they were going to go. That blew me away.
Yeah.
And it automatically said to me, excuse me, I didn't have that opportunity. My son, I tried to impress upon him. He's at the University of San Francisco. Mm-hmm. I tried to impress upon him. His focus is soccer. So that's all good. That's all well and good. But get your degree. Get your education. Mm-hmm. And what you said to me about at the age of your sons, mm-hmm. focusing, that blew me away. I said, damn, yeah. I missed an opportunity.
Well, I think that I learned about the missed opportunities that I didn't get. So I'm just trying to fill in the holes for what my father did not give me or couldn't give me, though it was painful. I remembered not to do that to my boys. I have a 14-year-old and a 12-year-old, two boys. And then being in this business, you know, it takes us away from family and children, wives and children. And because we have to do what we have to do to put the bread and the meat on the table and to get these kids through this thing called life. Mm. So I decided that I was going to put my boys, say some things early, plant the seed early.
That was a very conscious decision.
Yeah. But through that only came, that decision only came through pain.
Mm. Well, it's all painful.
True.
You know, it's all painful. My journey is a little different in that I've got a couple of different sets of kids, age-wise, which also manifests itself in differences in stages of career. Like you, Richard, my Ace Boone is my oldest daughter, who was there when things were not going so well career-wise, who remembers when I was sending she and her brother to school with whatever pennies that was out of my pocket on the nightstand that they had to collect to try to get lunch that day as a single parent, mm-hmm. which is what I was at that particular time when they were in my life. So she knows daddy wasn't always, quote, a movie star or a celebrity or whatever comes with whatever that title mm-hmm. is. And, you know, when we were eating potatoes, every meal. I can cook potatoes about 12 different ways, you know, to make a meal. So, and so there's a different reality there, you know, a different bonding there. Now, my younger kids, and I'll include my grandson in that, who was raised like my son, in our household, mm-hmm. along with my youngest daughter, the only one that Joanne and I have together. We're raised privileged. I had made some bucks, mm-hmm. and I was in the limelight, and it was a constant flow, and that's all they know. And our biggest qualm is, well, I know my oldest kids would say, Dad, you wouldn't let us get away with that shit. What they doing? Now. With that shit they doing? Now. You would not have let us get away with that shit. You know? Mm. And so my biggest thing has been, how do I adjust to this new way of raising kids, which, you know, my wife is 12 years younger than me, mm-hmm. you know, and my methods and hers conflict, mm-hmm. you know. And so at the same time, it's a matter of not giving in, you know, to the process of being there. Mm-hmm. And I get that from, like you, not having a father in my life. Mm-hmm. So it's hard for either of them, any of them, to shake me now that I am in their life and have been in their life. They can't shake me no matter what shit I've got to eat because I never had a father. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, my father came into my life. I was a grown man. You know, I was a father.
Yeah. You had set in your ways.
And I was setting, my twig was bent.
Yeah.
You know. Mm-hmm. So, not that we didn't have a great time when he did get here into my life. We had we made up for a lot of lost time, mm-hmm. you know, and which stops along the way to straighten shit out.
Right.
But at the same time.
He didn't meet a boy, he met a man.
Yeah, he met a man, you know.
And that changes the relationship.
That changed everything.
Because you were on your own and could make your own decisions and whatnot. And you had he had no ruling over you whatsoever.
Whatsoever, you know. So he had to accept me on that term.
Exactly.
And, but at the same time, you know, it's hard to explain if you're doing what we do, which is in mid-sentence or in mid-instruction or in mid-parenting, hold that thought. I've got to go over here for 3 months.
Yeah.
Well, that's a hell of a lot to put on a kid, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. 3 months, fuck you, Dad. I need you now.
Right.
And we need to work this out now, mm-hmm. you know. You don't like what I'm doing. I'd love to, but.
Yeah, you can't have that conversation. That doesn't,
you know,
doesn't compute. I remember my youngest having a tremendous beef with me, saying that she doesn't remember celebrating her birthdays.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, for the most part, on the road,
mm-hmm.
putting food on the table.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
And it wasn't until Mykonos this last summer that it was almost 5 years that we didn't talk.
Wow.
No communication.
Mm-hmm.
And in Mykonos, I had all my kids together.
Yeah, that's at one pictures. Time. That was great.
That is the most beautiful part of Mykonos.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Past that.
That's, hey, that's worth a lot.
Hello. And we started talking. So I said, wait. Let me ask you something. What is the wall between us?
Mm-hmm.
And it came down to a block that I put up. One summer, she took a trip to Europe, England, and I had their phones, my younger daughters, I took care of their phones.
Mm-hmm.
I got this bill that was stupid.
Mm.
So I called up and said, you know, I can't do this. It was like 700, you know. I I said, well, what, you should have told me, I can't do this. You know, this is a phone that I'm taking care of, but, you know, it's in my name, but you just don't go off to Europe and just charge up. And I won't divulge what she said to me, but.
Trust me, I've heard it. Trust me. Hmm.
And that was the end of the conversing with each other for almost 5 years.
Yeah.
But in Mykonos, we talked it out.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, the bottom line is whatever I did to make you angry, I'll take the blame.
Mm-hmm.
But you're my daughter and I love you to pieces. And let's get past this.
Mm-hmm.
And there, I mean, it was almost a movie moment. We were there on the balcony of this villa, and we hugged each other and fixed it.
Okay.
Amen.
Hey.
Amen.
It was a beautiful moment. Thank you.